Shabbat Shalom again, everyone. The Lord, let's get ready to pray for our children. Do the Sabbath prayer over them today. We're still in the high holy days. Next one coming up, even though it's not a feast day, it's Hanukkah coming up. Praise the Lord. Stretch your hands.
Protect and defend you. May he always shield you from shame. May you come to be in his world a shining flame. May you be like Ruth and like Esther. Deserving of praise, strengthen them, O Lord, and keep them from the stranger's ways. May God bless you and grant you long life.
Lord, fulfill our Sabbath prayer for you. May God make you good mothers and
may
wives.
He send you husbands who will care for you. May the Lord protect and defend.
Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Greet him in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, Shabbat. Shabbat, Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shabbat. Shabbat, Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Am Yisrael, Am Yisrael, Am Yisrael Chai. 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 Od Avinu Chai. Od Avinu Chai. Od Avinu, Od Avinu, Od Avinu Chai. Od Avinu Chai. Od Avinu Chai. Od Avinu, Od Avinu, Od Avinu Chai. Hevenu Shalom Alechem. Hevenu Shalom Alechem. Hevenu Shalom.
shalom, shalom alechem, hevenu shalom alechem, hevenu shalom alechem, hevenu shalom alechem, hevenu shalom, shalom, shalom alechem. Shalom, shalom, Yerushalayim. Shalom, shalom, Yerushalayim. Shalom, shalom, Yerushalayim. Shalom, shalom, Yerushalayim. Shalom, 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 Yerushalayim. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Jerusalem shall live in peace. Shalom, 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 Yerushalayim. Shalom, 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 Yerushalayim. Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom, Shabbat, 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 Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom,
hey,
Shabbat shalom.
Hey!
All right, praise the Lord. All right, we're going to start with prayer. Oh, I think I locked that, Alex. Praise the Lord. Well, we got prayer requests and praise report, but I know we have a couple of prayer requests. I know that Holly not feeling well, so we've got to pray for her. David had his surgery. I don't know. He probably not be. I don't know if he could drive or be able to come. Thanks. And I know he had his eye surgery. It looks like everything went well for his eye surgery. And if it works, I'd like to, you know, find out the bottom line, because, you know, people deal with floaters, and they said floaters are not operable. So I guess they this doctor just specializes in that. So if it works for David, it'd be good to know. So we kind of pray for David and Holly today. And anybody, and we're going to pray for, of course, for anyone here who has a prayer request. How many of you have a prayer request today? Yes, my sweetheart. Who wants to feel? Oh, so who passed away? Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah, I didn't know that. Oh, somebody call me, tell me that. So did it happen today? I don't know. Yeah. That was grandma. Gotta do that. Yeah, pray for travel emergency then. Yeah, well, I didn't know. And his mom passed away. So, and his grandmother lasted longer. Isn't that something? That normally happens in families. You know, when one passes on, I think it's like a, you know, yeah, it's like almost like a yearning in the heart or something, and it goes from one to the next, you know? I know it happened with us when my, in our family, I remember my brother-in-law passed away, which was unexpected. He died of a heart attack, and which he was like more like a brother than a brother-in-law. And then, like right after that, you know, my father passed away. And then my mother passed away. And then it was like, you know, it was like consecutive, you know. So it was like three in a row, you know. Yes. beautiful. She got a good heart. Yeah, I love her. I love her. When are you going to sing for me? You got to sing. You got to get ready to sing again. She could sing. She could sing. She's good. You got to do it again. All right? Well, get ready for a song. Hanukkah's coming, so you never know. God puts on your heart. I'm gonna get Joel to play for us for Hanukkah. I haven't spoken to him about it yet, but he's going to come and play for Hanukkah. Amen? 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 Well, you know, that's what we're supposed to do, put fire on those that, you know, that God's calling on, is on those people, on you especially. And that was beautiful last week. Joel did a beautiful job, man. Come on, put your hands together for Joel. He did a great job, and that was awesome. That was awesome, and, you know, so we look for. And again, you don't have to wait to Hanukkah. I told you already, whenever you feel led to play, you bring your violin, and we'll accommodate you, okay? Amen? Just keep on, get that fire going, man. Okay, anybody else, prayer requests? All those prayer requests so far. All right, let's just bow our heads and pray and get started with the service. But also, we're going. I have a. God put a special message in my heart today to share. Of course, we started the new Torah portions today, and we do have the new Torah cycles available for you. So we're going to have them at the end of the service. You can pick them up, and we just want you to, you know, follow those Torah cycle, and. But I believe that God also has a little message for us today about what's going on in the world. The world is really in chaos. And I was looking at the biblical calendar of 5780. And if you understand, there's a time period there also. The structure of the temple, there was almost like a period that it wasn't registered like. But it's still, in a way, the rabbis still register it. I mean, there's 240-year lapse. And if you take 5780 and add 240 to it, we're actually in the year 6020. So, and the Bible says in the 6 days, you know, God rested. And on the seventh day, I should say, I mean, 6 days rest. And then, of course, the Sabbath, right? So, I believe we're very close. I'm not going to say, you know, this is the year, but I believe according to that calendar, we're very close for the Lord's return. And the Bible says there will be labor pains in the world. You see the labor pains that are going on, and there's a couple of spirits that I'm going to talk about today that are part of that teaching of the book of Revelation as far as the seven churches are concerned. But there is a couple of spirits that I need to bring up again. One of them is the spirit of Leviathan, and the other one is the spirit of Jezebel. And Jezebel is very, very, very active right now. That spirit is highly active, you know, especially what's going on in the world and what's going on in our nation. So, but also what's going on in the body of Messiah, body of Christ. So we got to pray for that today, and I'm going to look at that. Okay? Hopefully you enjoy that message. But let's bow our heads and pray for those prayer needs. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, we just lift up these prayer needs today, and we thank you, Lord, that you have already answered them. You are El Shaddai. You are a great physician. You are El Gabor, Almighty God. So, Father, there is nothing impossible for you. And Father, we pray when two or more gather in your name, your word says that you are in the midst of it. And when two or more agree, whatever we agree on earth, it will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So Father, we thank you, Lord, for the healing. We thank you for divine intervention in people's lives, what Raya mentioned today, Father. And again, we pray for Timothy, who is to Georgia for his grandmother's death. Father, we pray for that family. Father, his mom just passed away recently, now his grandma. So we just pray for traveling mercy for them as they travel to Georgia. And Father, let them be, again, a light to the family, a vessel of hope and a vessel of comfort. And Father, we just thank you for all those who are sick in body today. We pray for Holly Malberg, who's not feeling well. I know she went for her test yesterday, and she's about to get ready to go for her surgery. And Father, and David also, who's recovering from his eye surgery. We just pray, Father, for divine healing and speedy recovery for David. And Father, again, for all those unspoken needs that we have in this room today, Father, we just pray, Father, that you have an answer for each and every one of us. And Father, we thank you, Father. We thank you for, again, Joe, Father, who's here today, and Esther, his wife, and again, his son, Father. We thank you, Lord. Father, we ask you, Lord, to bless them, Lord, guide them, protect them. And Father, we ask you to stir that fire inside of Joe, Lord, to continue to play for your glory and for your honor, Lord. And Father, we thank you, Lord. And we pray for their son Elijah, Lord, that their son Elijah will continue to be used mightily in the kingdom. And his wife Esther, Lord, we pray for her. And Father, we thank you, Lord, how you're using her and how you continue to use her. So, Father, we thank you in Yeshua's name for this service today. We dedicate everything to you, and let everything that happens here today be all of you and none of me in Yeshua's name. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for the word that's coming forth. We pray that it will land on fertile soil, and people will be changed by the power of your word, by the power of your name, and by the power of the blood of Yeshua. We thank you for the high holy days that we're celebrating. And Father, we ask you, Lord, again to continue to bless us. We surrender this service unto you, and everything again belongs to you, Lord. So we thank you in Yeshua's name. And all God's people say, amen and amen. Put your hands together, give him praise. Let's worship our God as we honor God in songs and praise. Hallelujah. Put your hands together. Get your tambourines out. Hallelujah. Let's worship our God.
Bound it.
Hallelujah. Praise him. Hallelujah. Come on, let's worship our God. He's a way maker, isn't he? He makes a way where there seems to be no way. He is our way maker. Thank you, Lord, for making a way for us. We can stand before you today with our heart opens to you, with our hands lifted up and pray.
You are here, moving in our midst.
Oh, yeah.
I worship you.
Oh, yeah.
I worship you.
Yes, Lord.
I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You make me miracle, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
Yes, Lord. His holy name. You are the way maker. Praise your holy name. Yeshua HaMashiach, our Messiah. We thank you, Father.
And I saw what looked like a sea of glass mixed with fire. And standing beside the sea, those who had been victorious. They held harps given them by God. And they sang the song of Moses
and
the
song
of the Lamb.
And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are your words.
God, hallelujah. This is the last song.
To the inner place.
Oh, I just love this song. How many of you want the Shekinah glory to fall upon you right now? Come on, let's just lift up our hands and let's sing this song together. Come on. And the altars are open. Come to the altar if you like and surrender everything today to the Lord. Hallelujah. Sing that to the Lord. Just say, fall on me.
Fall on me. Let your manifested glory fall on me. Fall on me.
Yes.
Fall.
Yes, let sing it. Lifting up your hands to the Lord. Come to manifest in your life like never before.
Oh!
Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together, give him praise. Let the manifested glory fall on all of us today. Praise his holy name. Hallelujah. How many of you love the Lord?
Amen.
Come on, put your hands together if you love him. Come on, that was a weak response, man. I mean, that was, oh man. God is grieving. He wants to hear your response. Come on, if you love the Lord, put your hands together and give him praise. Amen. Tell him how much you love him. Come on. Hallelujah. Well, he loves you first. That's for sure. He loved you first. Before you even thought of him. Where would you be without God today? Think about it. I don't know how people can just walk around thinking they could do things without him. I thought I could do things without him at one time. I think all of us had walked in that place. But I just want to give you a word of encouragement before we get into service. I want to dare you to do something. I want to dare you to imagine. I want you to picture this in your mind. A gravel strikes, shaking the courts of heaven, shattering major mindsets on earth, as a long overdue verdict is rendered. Permission granted to imagine. And corks blow as new wine gushes, hitting heaven's ceilings, emptying many bottles and bursting old wineskins. God's spirit of imagination begins flooding the nation. Imagine. I just want to say, imagine. The scripture becomes almost rhema, which basically is activating the hosts of angels. Now, to him who is able to do, and I'm going to say it this way, immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. Think about that. And I love that song, I Can Only Imagine. It was embraced by the world as a contagious message. I don't know if you got a chance to see that movie. If you haven't, it's a Christian movie called I Can Only Imagine. That's the guy who wrote it, and how his relationship was kind of not only with God, but with his earthly father in turmoil. But I believe God wants to convey that through us today, if you could only imagine. Our imagination wants to kick in more than we know, to run with the possibilities of God. With that said, I believe the Lord is saying, please let your imagination run wild when it comes to what I can do through you in this new era, 5780. And God says, you will never offend me in this. I promise, I dare you to imagine. We are made in his image. Come to somebody and say, you are made in his image. And the Lord created, and we're in Genesis, we're in the book of Bereshit today, the new Torah cycle. And the Lord created heavens and earth, and in Genesis 1:1, he pictured heaven and earth and all that is in it, including us, and the crown jewel of his creation. His imagination expressed through words painted a picture he spoke into existence in Genesis 1:3. We have been created in his image. When you say image, you know, we all look different. But we were created in his characteristics. Hello. Think about it. We have been created. Even my granddaughter has been created. Who's singing for Yeshua right now. Amen. Was created in his image. With the same, in other words, when he says, I created you in my image, in other words, I created you with the same nature and capability that God has. Think about it. We were made in his image to imagine. When we receive Yeshua as our Savior, he seals us with the Holy Spirit, giving us everything we need for life and, again, godliness. For as a man, what? Thinketh, so is he. So how are you thinking? How are we thinking now in this new year? We are all products of what we think. Come on, everybody say amen. Our mindset, if you think lousy thoughts, you're going to have a lousy day. You're going to have a lousy attitude, right? If someone says apple, we do not see the word apple spelled out, but we picture what? An apple. Now, my question is, what kind of apple? Red apple? Macintosh? I like Macintosh. Green apples? Yellow apples? But we think in pictures, right? Likewise, if we picture ourselves poor, hello, it will be poor. If we picture ourselves doomed, we'll be doomed. If we picture ourselves healthy, hello? And that's how you got to picture yourself, healthy. Then we will be healthy. Amen? And now you say, wait a minute, but I think that, but my body is telling me something different. Tell your body it's healthy. Tell that pain, you know, there, it's healthy. Whatever image we see in our minds, we go and paint it on our hearts. This picture is expressed further through our words. For out of the mouth, what does it say? From the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Right? Or speaks, right? Matthew 12:34. Imagine the womb of creativity. Most of us are familiar with Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him was able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. But however, many of us fail to meditate on the second half of the verse, which reads, according to what? Your power? According to his power that works within us. This is the key. Come on. Everybody say, this is the key. It's his power that works in us. When you're weak, you're strong. Now, think about that for a second. For even though we have all the resurrection power we will ever need living in us, for those who are in Christ, think about it. We can still limit the work of his spirit within us. The limiting of God happens in our minds. We sometimes limit God. We stifle him. And we have it, and we do it with vain imagination. And sometimes we should avoid altogether, which again, the void. Everybody say, I'm going to avoid vain imagination. In other words, this is not true. In other words, don't believe something that's not true. God has given us the power to imagine. Let us be conscious that when we use our imagination in partnership with the Holy Spirit, his plan for us will come forth. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. What is that scripture? Jeremiah 29:11, one of my favorites. Now, these thoughts we think towards us are his imaginations. The word for imagination in Hebrew, I want you to write this down. I'm going to spell it for you. M-A-C-H. M-A-C-H. And I want you to put a dash after that. A-F-H A-B-A-H Mahashaba, meaning designs, inventions, thoughts. It can be related to basically even intricately woven plans like a tapestry. That is the word imagine, imagination. Mahakaba. Now, think about it. Spirit-filled imagination. That's how you should think. Say spirit-filled. Now be careful what kind of spirit. That's the whole thing. Because there's spirits out there, they don't want you to imagine the right things. But imagine Holy Ghost spirit-filled imaginations. And the Lord calls us to partner with Him, don't He? So when we are born again, His Spirit dwells alongside our spirits. And when we become powerful, imagination, we should become an imagination station. Turn to somebody and say, you are a station of imagination. Come on. Because He came to give His life, right?
Yes.
And give it to us more abundantly, John 10:10. But the devil also comes to steal and destroy. So this is the year. Everybody say, what is this year talking about? 5780. What do we say God wants us to do this year? We mentioned this a few times. See if you took notes and you remember. Exactly. And we are to do what? Speak. Speak. The Ancient of Days will have it all. In other words, this ties in. We are existing in what? 5780. Right? We just finished 5779. And in other words, the decade of 70s. The decade of 70s was what? Remember what I mentioned? Vision. Right? Now we're in AN. The picture of an eye. In other words, that was the picture of the eye. Vision. But now we're in what? Pay. P-E-Y. Which is the letter what? For mouth. 5780. Means pay. A picture of a mouth. An opening of an entrance. It means to speak. Can somebody say speak it? Declare it. And command it. Come on, you got to sell it. You know, when you feel and go, oh, I feel pain. I claim, I speak right now healing. I declare divine recovery and healing. And I command whatever I have that is not of you, Lord, to go in Yeshua's name. Amen? So after wrapping up a decade of vision, now we have to wrap up a decade of speaking. So remember, we're in the 5780, a new decade. So the Lord is saying, I have trained your eyes to see. I have given you the ability to see in the Spirit with perfect clarity. And I believe David Malberg, after that surgery, is going to have more perfect clarity. And you have everything you need to imagine perfectly, God says. So as we move into 5780, I want you to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit baptize you all over again. Let your lips move in heavenly language, because God says, I have ordained you to do so. Do not forsake praying, even in tongues. If God has given you the gift of speaking in tongues, pray in tongues. Now, if you have not had that gift, come and see me. We'll pray over you and see if you receive it. Now, remember, we don't, you know, it's not a, if it's God's will for you to have it, you will have it. Amen? It's okay. Now, some of you say, well, speaking in tongues, I'm afraid of that. Well, don't be afraid of that. It's just the Holy Ghost speaking, praying. Okay, now, people say, well, what if I don't have it? Does that mean I'm not a Christian? No. Doesn't mean anything. In other words, those are gifts. Those are manifested gifts. For example, if a pastor or a preacher sings and plays an instrument, does that make him more anointed from a pastor that doesn't play and sing? Does it make him more anointed? No. That's just a special gift that he got to do. So in other words, tongues is just a gift. And if you haven't received it and you want us to pray over you, please do, we'll do so after the service. You have to have a faith. Say, imagine speaking in tongues. Amen? And I've seen people try to put tongues on people, and some of that stuff is not, it's like grabbing the throat and shaking you and pounding on you, and that doesn't happen that way. Amen? It's a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Amen? So let's begin this year, 5780, imagining. I want to imagine our congregation full. I want to imagine our congregation paid in full. The mortgage paid in full. I'm going to imagine that everyone here is going to be debt free. I'm going to imagine everyone here is going to be more healthy than ever before. I'm going to imagine that all of us will have long life, l'chaim. Long life. That we will have, again, healthy, physically, emotionally, mentally, physically, financially, spiritually, health this year. Amen? Amen? So let your imagination start with that. Let's start seeing. Remember, this is the year of seeing. That's seeing and speaking. Remember, we went through that decade of seeing. Now let's get into the decade of speaking it out. Everybody say amen. Hallelujah. Look at that. I just imagine Holly, and look, she showed up.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. Imagine. See, imagine that. Praise the Lord. When you see zeros in your checking book, imagine the Father. I see numbers in front of those zeros. And now those zeros have added, instead of just having two zeros, now I got nine zeros after that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on, you got to start imagining things. So everybody say, if I could only imagine. Amen. Praise the Lord. Father God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, we thank you, Lord, that we are. I pray that this manifestation of imagination has transferred into our people's lives. And those who are watching on the internet, Father, we pray for every single person. Father, touch them physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, Lord. Father, we thank you for their support to this ministry. We thank you for them watching us and praying for us, Lord. And Father, we just pray that this message today will be a blessing to them. So Father, we thank you in Yeshua's name, and all God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Put your hands together and give him praise. Let's turn the lights on. And now, without no further ado, I'm going to call on my sister, Carla Adams, to come and take the tithes and offering. Come on, somebody.
Thank you, Rabbi. Shabbat shalom. How's everyone today? I missed y'all last week. So, as we prepare, ask the ushers to prepare to take up our tithes and offering. And if you need an envelope, or it's in the front seat in front of you, if you need a form, just raise your hand. And to our viewing audience, please join us in this worship in our tithes and offering. So yes, I was out last week. We had the flood and the storm, but guess what? That was my week for my tithes. Just call Linda. So that's my encouragement to you too. No matter where you at, we have technology. You can call, you can text. And for those that are tuning in today, you can see our contact information, and you can please call us and join us in this worship. Because, it's a process. Even though I'm not here, that's part of my being consistently consistent. Remember, we talked about that. We have to work the process. A lot of times we have to focus more on the process than we do the result. Let me say that again. I don't think that registered. You need to focus on the process more than you do the result. Now, I reflect on the results, and, I'll just say for me. Let me speak for myself. I know where I'm at to this day, I can say Yeshua has never failed me. That's the end result. It's a blessing I'm standing up here today to share part of my testimony with you, because where would we be without the Lord? But you know, it's a process. What process? Glad you asked. This process. This is our process that He gave us. He gave us specific instructions on what we're to do with our money. We're here talking about money, getting your tithes ready. And here is the process. Where are you in the process? He said, bring the tithes. Consistent? Or are you still working to get to the point, because we're all at different places, that you can give your full tithes? If that's where you at, great. Can you do your tithes and offering? There's another little small word that's in this word. It's three letters, and. Tithe and offering. Is that where you at in the process? You can do your tithes and offering? Great. Let's take it to the next step. What else he say in this word for us to do? Bring our special offering. I think it's in Leviticus 23, keep me honest, think 36. That's the season that we're in. You're supposed to bring your special offering. Is that where you at? It's not too late. We're in the season and celebrating our festivals. Where are you in the process? It's personal. I don't know. I don't look at the records. But it's personal between you and Yeshua. Where you are in being obedient and following the process. Because one thing that we know, if you follow the process, you'll get results. Let me use the gym as an example. Well, who go to the gym 2 or 3 times a week? But you know what? It's a process. You go consistently, you'll see the results. So you don't have to tell me if you go to the gym or not. I can look at you. And I can see if you've been following the process. If you follow the process, you will get results. You can look at your life. If you're following the process, you're going to get the results. You have to work it. Work it. Work the process. Look at the person next to you and say, you got to work it. Come on. You got to work it. You have to work it. This is the work that we have to put in. We're talking about money. That's the second most talked about topic in this process, in the Bible, is money. You got to work the process to get the results. Amen. Work it. Say it with me. Work it. Work it. Work it. Work it. Come on, ushers. Let's work it. Let's work it. Pastor Evelyn. Can I ask you to come and pray over our tithes and offering? Where's my ushers? Could everyone stand? Stand, please. Work it. Hallelujah. Come on, work it.
Hallelujah. Father, I just pray for each and every person that's giving in this offering today, Lord, that you will multiply exceedingly.
I want you to write this down. If we can. Because this is a subtitle of my message today. Concept of God's kingdom. What is this kingdom? And we're in the book of Bereshit, which means in the beginning of Genesis 1. And I tell you what, I could probably teach in the book of Genesis for probably a year and I finish it. In fact, when we first studied it in Bible school, we actually studied it for a whole year, just the book of Genesis alone. Because there's so much in it from the very beginning. Now, I'm going to give you a scenario, a synopsis of all of this. And I look at today's world, what's going on, and how God created his kingdom in the beginning. And the more I see it, I truly believe this is true, because the Bible was written from a political government perspective. Hello? Now, I know many people will differ and say, oh, we don't want to add politics into the... It's not about adding politics to the church. But the Bible was written, if you understand something, from a political government perspective. It's his government. what was the word in Isaiah? And the government shall be what? On his shoulders. All right? So, now, how many attempt to confine the Bible as a religious perspective. Okay? Even in our country, people want to detach themselves from religion, calling for the separation of church and state. Yet the wisdom of the scriptures cries out saying that we cannot separate church and state. That's the problem with the government separating themselves. And some of them call themselves Christians. You cannot separate it. How can you say abortion is legal when the Word of God says it isn't? Amen. It's a woman's right to do whatever she wants to do. The Bible says, you are not of your own. You don't belong to you. You belong to God. And God created you. Adam was never given a religion. Hello? Amen. He was never given and as a matter of fact, he was given actually a government. Yeah. When Adam disobeyed God, he lost the government of God. Amen. Or the governing authority that he had. And ever since, humanity has been trying to regain God's government. Hello? Religion is man's effort to reach God after the fall. And we don't follow religion. God never created religion. Religion is just a man-made method of trying to figure out God or reach God. And look how many religions are there. And if you understand the total number of religions, if you look at the total number of religions that there are in the world, okay? The number is astonishing, because the number of religions that there are in the world is the number six, 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 the number of the beast. Hello? God determined the time in which the government will be restored upon the earth. And Yeshua brought back the government of God. When he came to establish, when he told us, teach us to pray, Rabbi. Lord, teach us to pray. Well, he says, what? Our Father who art in heaven, right? Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom, right? His government come on earth as it is in heaven. So he started off with the kingdom, the government. For us to regain the government, we cannot see Yeshua as just a spiritual leader only. Yeah, he's a spiritual leader, but we also have to see him as also a political leader. There's a his political position was very strong. There's a difference between religious leader and a political leader. Many limit Yeshua as a priest or a prophet rather than a king. A king is not a religious leader. A king is a politician. How about say amen? Now, 1 Samuel 2:8. If you could read that, Chuck. 1 Samuel 2:8. We're going to kind of keep your finger in Genesis, because we're going to go back to that. That's going to be our basis. Then we're going to get into also some things that I believe the Lord has put on my heart to share. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8.
He lifts the poor from the dust and the needy from the garbage dump. He sets them among princesses, placing them in seats of honor. For all the earth is the Lord's, and he has set the world in order.
Okay. So he lifts the poor from the dust, and the needy from the garbage dump, and he sets them among princesses, placing them in seats of honor. For all the earth is the Lord's, hello, and he has set the world, where? In chaos? In order. So what is it saying? There's pillars on the earth. All the pillars on the earth are the Lord's. And he has set the world upon them. The English word earth, if you look at that word, the English word earth and world are often sometimes interchangeable in our language. But in Hebrew, however, earth and world refer to two separate things. You may want to write this down. The earth refers to the place, the physical planet, on which we reside. But the world refers to order or governing affairs. Let me repeat that. The earth represents a place where we live, a physical planet where we reside. The world refers to the governing or order of governing affairs. So God created the physical earth, and then he established the world. Right? Come on, in the beginning. His government and divine order is on that. He is a God of order. Come on. Right? Earth deals with location, where things are occurring, while world deals with who is running. Come on, somebody. Who's running things? Huh? It sure ain't Trump. It sure ain't Pelosi. Definitely not Hillary. Right? In other words, it's not a it's not these politicians who's running things. Who's running things? God. In Matthew 16, Yeshua asked, why do men say that I am? In other words, the average person then and now answered that Yeshua was believed to be what? How did they answer him when he asked that question? The prophet Elijah. Or a teacher? You were a rabbi. Like John the Baptist, remember? But none of those answers were the word that he wanted to hear. Nobody said king. Incredibly, many still answer the question in the same way. Few today will say that Yeshua
is king, was and is king. Few will still say the term world means order or governing affairs, and even fewer will even say that the Torah was put in place. Some people don't even believe that, well, the Torah, you mention the word Torah to certain people, and they think, oh man, you're a Jew, you're legalistic, and we're under the law, we've done away with that, Christ, you know, come on, all that stuff. But the Torah was put in place by what? By the Holy Spirit to govern the earth. This is our government of God. To identify Yeshua as a prophet puts him in a context of a class like who else would they call a prophet? Muhammad. A spiritual leader, right? Or liken unto Buddha. Or liken unto Confucius. Right? Which people are still confused. Right? Mashiach in Hebrew. What's Mashiach mean? Anointed one. Mashiach. HaMashiach. In other words, the anointed one. Yeshua HaMashiach. Yeshua, the anointed one. There's only one anointed. Hello? And Muhammad and Confucius ain't it. Ecclesia, we heard the word ecclesia, right? To us in Spanish, it's the iglesia. Ecclesia is not a religious word. The Greeks, believe it or not, invented that word ecclesia and the idea of what? Democrat. Hello? From which we get the word democratic. The Romans adapted Greek philosophy and were the first to implement the ecclesia. Caesar had an ecclesia, a government agency, which was a group of people appointed by the king to execute the king's ideas and the king's intentions in the king's empire. The ecclesia was never appointed to counsel the king. The king counsels the ecclesia. Now, there's a great failure in the average, hate to say that, church today, in establishing elders and boards and elders and deacons and all that stuff. I mean, it's nothing, you know, sometimes it's not wrong. We have deacons in our church and elders. But responsible, but they're not responsible to hire or fire me. All right? Because the one who appointed me was God. And he's the only one that could fire me. Even my wife can't fire me. Amen. Everybody say amen. Amen. But the way the structure is of the church today is wrong. That's a Greek model, not a Hebrew model. A system disguised as religious accountability. Well, we have to have accountability, which in reality has no biblical, validity. Really, it doesn't have any. God does not ordain or endorse this flawed model of leadership. Nor did Paul in the manner that we see it manifested today. Biblical leadership, as opposed to the Greek model, understand that the ecclesia is not positioned to question the king. Questioning the king is a challenge to his authority, and again, as a form of rebellion against the king. But God has a government, hello, in which he wants us to operate in. The Torah gives us what? 613 legal actions or positions designed to equip his people to govern. Yeshua declared his government in Matthew 5:17-19. Faith, everybody, I want you to write this down especially. Faith is not religion. I want you to say that with me. Say faith. It's not religion. Faith, write this down. Faith is obedience to a constitution, to the king who wrote that constitution. And his name is Yeshua HaMashiach. From the time Yeshua began to preach, to teach, and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. When Yeshua came to the earth as a king, he represented a divine imperial kingdom that was not operating on the earth. He didn't claim to have come as a prophet or a religious leader or a religious man. His statement is very clear. You say rightly that I am a king, John 18:37. The gospel records that when Yeshua emerged from the wilderness, he announced the arrival of what? What did he say? The arrival of his kingdom. And declare his legal position as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Everybody say amen. Now, let's look at this. Now, if we could, Chuck, before we go into Bereshit, let's go to Matthew 13. How many of you, did that get you thinking already? A little bit differently? Let's go to Matthew 13, verse 11 and 11 and 12. So it says, for they look, but they don't really see. They hear, but they don't really listen or understand. If they did, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in. Amen. As many churches that we have in this world, in this country, come on, we're considered to be the Bible Belt. Have you ever driven in the southern states? I mean, you know, I mean, Florida, Georgia, I mean, you go, it's one church after the other. I mean, in every corner, bam, 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 bam. The Church of Christ and Baptists, and then there's all kinds of Baptists. Southern Baptists, you know. Baptists, whatever. You know, they got all kinds of churches all over the place. And they haven't made a difference. Think about it. In the government today, the government in Washington is still needing help. A lot of help. Okay? Now, I want you to write this down. God is the God of order, right? Okay, so write this down. By examining the order of the Torah, a man sets out to walk in that order. By examining the order of the Torah, a man or woman sets out to walk in that order. But the reason it says man, because man has to start it. If a man walks in order, trust me, that woman has no problem following him in order. A woman is not going to follow. See, by nature, a woman will like to follow the man. But a woman is not going to follow a man that's not following the order of God. Right? Hello? If they're out of order in so many different ways, why would a woman follow that? Because what's the number one need of a woman? Security. Right? Security of a spiritual leader. Let's finish that sentence. Right? They need a spiritual leader. In other words, one that will direct them in a godly manner. He's not going to make decisions on any, you know, whim or all kinds of, you know, emotion. Right? Because women want to follow, but if the man is not going in the right direction, women will, you know, go somewhere else and do their own thing. Hello? Okay, now, write this down. Moral order and physical order will be present by examining the order of the Torah. So moral order, and what's happening today in this world? Moral order is in chaos. Physical order, Because if there's moral order, then there's physical order. Are you kidding me? Are you following me? If there's moral order, there is physical order. Say that with me. If there's moral order, there is physical order, right? So as you can, in other words, as you walk in the Torah, order will pursue you. Whoa. As you walk in God, order will follow me. Okay? Because everything that is done on earth is a reflection of the heavenly realms or God's kingdom. So that's why Torah should be your life for how you are to live in the earth realm. Right? Because that's why he gave it to us. He gave us a constitution. I hear all the time in Washington, well, we're not following the Constitution. Well, the Constitution says this. And then they take the Constitution and they add something else to it that they want to, come on, manipulate. Sounds like a preacher trying to do that. They take the word and they twist it, right? It's not really what the word of God is saying, right? Like people, you know, you see all the time. They get a document and they take the document, and this is what the document says, but I'm going to give you my interpretation of the document. That's what preachers do. You got to follow. The Bible says, don't add or take away from the word. Follow what the word of God says. Right? Okay. So the Torah is the book of order, correct? Okay? So that's how we live on the earth. Now, what is all, you know, when you think about the Bible, it's actually called, okay, write this word down, mystery of the gospel. How many of you ever heard that? Mystery of the gospel. How many of you like mysteries? People like mysteries. Oh, man, all these mystery shows go on. Mystery of the gospel. Well, we just read it in Matthew 13. You are permitted to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven. Now, think about it. Turn to somebody and say, you are permitted to understand the secrets. The question is, do you understand them? Right? Yeah. Pray for revelation. I mean, really, you should always get into a habit before you even open up the word and pray. Before you read the word, pray. Say, Father, as I read this word, may I get revelation from you. Get revelation, okay? Let him reveal your secrets to me. Yeah. Remember, there's different levels of reading the Torah, the Bible, and there's a soul level. The soul level is the hidden level that God doesn't give it to everybody. That hidden level is only when God says, you know why it's not given to everybody? Because If people are already misusing the word as it is, why would God give them secrets and then they misuse it anyway? God's not going to give somebody the word in secret and then they're going to take it and misuse it or manipulate it to somebody else and get whatever they want out of it. Come on. Right? So, understand the mystery of the gospel. So it says here, to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but others are not. Those who listen to my teaching, more understanding will be given, and they will have an abundance of knowledge. Right? But those who are not listening, and what little understanding they have, it will be taken away from them. Wow. Isn't that something? God says, I'm not going to play with this person here. I'm tithing is of God. Well, you're not tithing. Well, God, you know, God may start speaking to you after a while because you're not listening. Amen. Hello? Or you may not even feel the manifestation of God. Because again, the manifestation comes upon you when you obey God. It comes upon you. When you disobey God, God walks away. Right? I know, it's not that he'll leave you completely, but he'll just say, okay, well, I'll let him go in his own little, I'll let her and him go in their own little path because they'll learn the hard way. And one day, you know, when all hell breaks loose and they finally cry out to God, oh, finally, you know, now you get it. Oh, I could have saved you all that trouble if you would have done it from the beginning. Come on. Now, the purpose of the word is so God can create, in other words, not the word, but the world. The purpose of the world is that so God can create a place where his divine light can be hidden, right? Because again, if you look at the word Bereshit, and the word Bereshit is basically so many different terms for the word Bereshit. But let's look at this. Bereshit means the beginning, correct? Right? Now, there's two major factors where existence, what God is. Again, remember we said before, there is physical body, but there is heaven and earth, right? His Torah and his light. The Torah is the, again, Genesis, or again, you know, from Genesis to Deuteronomy, I mean to Numbers, and I mean Deuteronomy, but then again, if you continue, the Torah is from Genesis to Revelation. Now, write this down. God is the source of life. Right? God is the source of all life. So he knew in advance, think about it, he knew in advance the existence of every person who will ever be born on the world. He knew that. He knew in advance the existence of every person who will be born into the world. He actually knew your name, your purpose, before you were even formed in the womb. He planted out your future, your occupation, and your purpose. That is why you must believe that life is worth living, right? So to take a life because it's I feel like it is my right to do so. And abort? That's not your call. In fact, everything that you see was hidden and encoded in the letters of the Torah scroll. The Torah has written, in other words, was written everything you could see, everything you could ever think of. Every motion, every movement, every person is in the Word. Can I tell you something? It is a privilege to study the Torah. Amen. Some people go, I don't like reading the Word. It is a privilege. Because you know why? When you read the Torah, the Bible, you read in the mind of God. You want to know the mind of God? Read it. The reason your mind is not in line with the mind of God, because you're not reading it. Or you're not understanding it. Hello? Okay? Everybody say amen. So again, the word Bereshit in there has so many different words. It has the word bar, which means, again, sun. It has a, in other words, everything is in that word alone in the beginning. Okay? Now, let me, I don't have time to get into all of this because I see the clock is running fast. But I want you to go to Job 38. As you turn in there, I want you to think about something. Job 38. How many of you ever thought of being an agent? Anybody ever felt like, I want to be an FBI agent or CIA agent? Come on. I don't know. When I grew up, right? I mean, isn't that cool? I mean, I want to be an agent, man. I grew up with people like Shaft. 007. I grew up with all those, you know, I mean, I watched every 007. Sean Connery, to me, is my favorite 007. I heard they're trying to come out with another 007, a woman now. All right. Woman's lib. All right? All right, let's go to Job 38. Now, guess what? Everyone here, turn to someone and say, you are an agent. Whether you like it or not, you are. You are an agent. God created you to be an angel of change. Isn't that something? All right. Chuck, verse 1 through 7, Job 38.
Then the Lord answered Job.
People do not die, or children do not die and become angels. That's a myth. Oh, my baby's an angel. No. Angels were already created. When were they created? Right here. When God was laying the foundation of the earth, of the universe, of everything, he says he had angels shouting for joy. So that means that the angels were already created when he started creating. Hello. All right? And then, so he keeps on going here, but this is a real powerful chapter. Now, listen, just to add to that, before you came into the knowledge of the Torah, being on the earth was without form and void, right? In the beginning. And there was what? Chaos. There was nothing but chaos. Trouble. Right? And how many of you, before the Torah, even though you may even was maybe a Christian, it was still kind of voided in certain places. There was still chaos, a lot of chaos, and it was all over you, right? Now, the only reason the world was created is so that the light can go into the darkness to reveal its purpose. Did you get that? All right, let me say that slowly. The only reason the world was created is so that the light, was the light, God, the light, can go into darkness and reveal his purpose. Right? So since there is light, hello, the purpose of creation is the first thing to be decided to bring order on the earth. Because light brings order in darkness. Right? So when you were in darkness, hello, light came to you to bring you back to order and for you to fulfill your purpose and design on the earth. Come on. Now you know why you're here. Listen, you don't choose how long you even exist on the earth. No one can tell. You can't just say, okay, God, I want to live so long. I would like to live, yeah. Everybody wants to, like, want to have, you know, a long life. But you can't decide how long you're going to live. Right? Who does? The creator of all things. But the more you operate in his order, watch this now. Let me show you something. The more you operate in his order, the longer you are illuminated by his light and will exist. Hello? Now you see, you cannot truly operate without order. Purpose of light. Imagine you trying to live things without order. Imagine if even everything you do, come on, you are order. You get up in the morning, you already have an order going. Right? I know most of you don't want to get out of bed, but you get out of bed anyway. Right? And I don't know how you haven't bumped your foot in a long time, because I don't know how you do it. You got one eye open, one eye closed, and you stumble. You know, and you normally, you know, I don't know if you have some of you. The first thing you do is the coffee pot goes on. Some of you have it automatically on a timer, but you set the clock and you do the coffee first, and after you get the coffee going and brewing, then you go into the bathroom and then you look in the mirror. And thank God you haven't scared yourself yet. And you see that face, you say, oh my God, Lord have mercy. And you know, and you gotta change all this stuff, and you see that boogie stuff coming out of your eyes, and you know, so you have an order. Right? Right? All right? So, in other words, you were created to operate in order. Right? That's the purpose of God and light and Torah. You were created to boulders. Like, I want you to say to yourself this. I was created to be the holder of light. Hello. Come on. You were created to be the holder of light, holders of the Torah, from the foundation of the world when God created in Genesis. 1:1 in the beginning. Isn't that something? All right, let's go to, okay, let's look at Ephesians chapter 3. See, what happened to Genesis 1? We'll go back to it again. I know we opened there, we haven't got there yet. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9 through 12. Chuck. Ephesians 3, 9 through 12.
I was chosen to explain to everyone this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, had kept secret from the beginning. God's purposes in all this was to use the church to display the wisdom in its rich variety to all the unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was his eternal plan, which he carried out through Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord.
I like that. Isn't that something? So now, again, I like the way it reads. I was chosen to explain to everyone, in other words, Paul, this mysterious plan that God, the creator of all things, has kept secret from the beginning. Right? God's purpose. What?
God's purpose
was to use what?
Use us.
The church. And when we say, okay, the church, when he says church, it means people. Okay, it's only a building can only do so much, right? A church is just a place where we come in to facilitate things and gather. But it says, I've chosen the word I would have worded it differently. It says the purpose was to use the people of God to display His wisdom and His rich variety to all unseen rulers and authorities in the heavenly place. When you see unseen rulers and authority, He's talking about demonic activity. Right? He's talking about demonic activity, unseen, right? The rulers of darkness in the heavenly places. Right? Now think about this for a second. This was His eternal plan. And our faith in Him, we can now come boldly and come confidentially into God's presence. So it says again, verse 13, do not lose heart because of what? My trials. How many of you are going through trials? God says don't lose heart. Amen. We all going through trials. Matter of fact, let me tell you something. I'd be really worried about you if you didn't go to trials. Because if the devil ain't messing with you, you probably have a good hangout with him every day. You're hanging out with the brother. Because the devil's not gonna mess with those who are with him. He's gonna mess with those that are not with him. Because he's trying to get you to be discouraged. Yeah. Right? Come on. Everybody say amen. Amen. All right? So, and this is His eternal plan, which He carried through Yeshua HaMashiach. All right? Okay, now. In other words, all right, let me kind of, I'm going to give you, and I need to really have time to mention what I wanted to mention. So in this verse, in these verses, in other words, you were ordained, write this down. You were ordained to rule over darkness. Now, we were taught in the church, run from darkness. Now, I'm not saying purposely run to darkness. Okay. Okay. In other words, I'm not telling you purposely run to the bar in the corner and go in there and, you know, unless the Lord really ordained you to go in there. I mean, I there was a story that I read one time in the paper about this guy that he felt to go and evangelize in a bar. But the way he did it was totally, you know, he went into the bar and he basically was just making an excuse for his alcoholism. And basically he was going in there because his wife told him not to ever go back to the bar again because he'll lose his marriage. He said, but what if I go in there? He was telling his wife, but I'm going in there and witnessing about the Lord. But he was getting drunk with everybody else. I mean, that's kind of crazy. I mean, now if you're going to go in there and witness to these people, it's different, okay? But you don't do exactly what they all do, right? Now, I want you to write this word, catalyst. K-A-T-A-L-Y-S-T, catalyst. I want you to be a catalyst in this new year. A catalyst. What is a catalyst? It's a person or thing that causes or occurs a change. You have to cause change for the better. Hello? A personal thing that causes or occurs a change. Now, write this down. Problems are the catalyst for creativity. All right? Come on. God gave you problems for a reason. Problems are the catalyst for creativity. So in other words, problems, you should cause a change in that problem. Right? In other words, if you want to see more light, we are brought into hidden darkness. Hello? So when people told you in the church, you got to run from darkness, well, how are you going to overcome darkness and get rid of darkness if the light that's in you is supposed to change that darkness? You're going to run from it, so that darkness continues. So you got to be a witness, right? So if you walk into a room and you walk in with God, you should be able to change the atmosphere. Right? You should be able to change. I mean, I don't know about you, but, you know, I mean, you can walk into a room. I know it's happened to me. Not because maybe people know that I'm a pastor or, you know, but I could walk in and matter of fact, I remember going to a place. It's been a long time ago, but I went into a place and I could tell everybody was like, you know, you could tell this was not the best place to be at, but I don't know how I walked in there, but I think I had to use the bathroom or something. And everybody was like smoking and drinking and cursing and all that. But I walked in there, didn't know anybody. Walked in there and everybody kind of, they just watched me. I said, hello, can I use your bathroom? And everybody was like, I guess they must have seen a light. Amen. Hello. This happened to us one time. We were eating. As a matter of fact, we finished church service. We were renting a church on 26th Street, and we went to the Village Inn off of Fowler and 30th Street. And we were there, and a Satanist walks in. How do I know it was a Satanist? This guy was in black with a hexagram. I mean, this guy, you could tell he was a Satanist from head to toe. And when he walked in, we were sitting there. When he walked in, he would not take his eyes off of me. I go, what's up? Power, man. You know, I mean, you could tell that he knew who we were. There was darkness. And again, we just have to show the light. And you can see the way we were reacting. As a matter of fact, we used to kind of, you know, really talk about the Lord and pray and all that stuff. That the manager of the restaurant loved us to go in there. We used to go almost every week after service, and we were in there. Matter of fact, she says, "You know what? I just love you guys." I said, "Yeah, I know you're a pastor. God has told me to give 10%." Of everything you spend back to the church." So she started giving us a tithe for going in there. Come on, somebody, that's favor. So you have to incur change, right? Come on, everybody say amen. I mean, that's how we got to be. All right, everybody say a catalyst. All right? Say, so you have to, don't be afraid of darkness, man. Your job to say, darkness, go. All right? You have authority of God. All right? Because order brings increase. Everybody say amen. All right. Let me finish this. I want to share something real quick. Remember, I mentioned before that the government of God is political, right? And I think you finally realize by now that in Washington, we have a Jezebel spirit. Hello? In Revelation, let's go to Revelation. We remember we started before the beginning of the year that we're going to get into all the seven churches. And this is what we're dealing with today. chapter 2. Okay. And it says, let's read from the beginning. Chuck, if you could read, just start Ephesians 2, verse 2 to 3.
Verse
2
to
3. Revelation, I should say. Yeah, Revelation 2.
Revelation.
I'm back in Ephesians. Revelation 2.
Verse 2 and 3.
Verse 2 to 3.
I know all the things you do. I have seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You have discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting.
Okay, now, so I know we started off with that, and we're going to go to the next church of Smyrna, but I'm going to skip a little bit and let's go to chapter 2, but let's go to verse 18, the church of Thyatira, okay? And let's go to, let's just start with verse 20. Verse 20 to 21.
Still chapter 2.
Of Revelation 2, verse 20.
But I have this complaint against you. You are permitting that woman, that Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet, to lead my servants astray. She teaches them to commit sexual sin and to eat food offered to idols. I gave her time to repent, but she does not want to turn away from her immorality.
Okay. All right, I'm going to stop there because I have about only 8 minutes left. But in Washington, we have the spirit of Jezebel. Amen. What is it doing? It's fueling the immorality of our nation.
Yes, yes,
yes. You agree?
Yes.
In other words, while I'm going to, for the sake of words, religious right fueled by a religious spirit stands to make certain that no law is changed because the two are in constant deadlock and division. Hello? Now, in the majority of the church, we see sometimes these spirits operating for those who confess that they are saved. But they don't operate according to the Holy Spirit or the fruits of the Spirit. Now, so there is a difference between, write this down, saved folks and disciples. There's a big difference. Saved folks from disciples. Some people say they're saved, but they're not disciples. They're not Talmudims. We all have a choice. We can choose to be honest with God and admit that this has been an influence in our lives according to our ways, or we just keep on doing what we're doing. Because you have been under the, listen to me, because if you're operating as saved and not really making a change, then you have been influenced by Jezebel. Or religious spirit. All right? And it doesn't mean that you're possessed. Doesn't mean you're possessed. It means you're being influenced. Those who are usually tend to be, watch this now. How many of you have seen, in Washington especially, people are just vindictive. And if you cross that, if you cross their path, then they will come after you big time.
Yeah,
and that's the spirit of Jezebel. But there is no, in other words, but there is no fear. In other words, we are not afraid of, we should not be afraid of these spirits. Say, I shall have no fear. Remember, that's darkness. You have light. Aura inside of you. Torah. You have to get that light and confront that darkness. And we have to, in other words, we have to choose to acknowledge that we have, if we have been influenced, then we have to choose to walk away from that influence or stay walking with it. We will not take the spirit head on sometimes because we know that sometimes, you know, we're afraid or whatever, or I don't know if I can handle it or whatever. But you know what? That's where we come together as a body. We have to choose to repent and allow the Lord to deal sometimes with these strongholds. Hello? I want you to write this down. Today is a choice. The Bible says choose today who you will serve. Amen. It's a choice. We have to make a choice. Every moment of your life, you got to make a choice. If you're going to scratch your nose, you got to make a choice to scratch your nose. Right? If you're going to get up, you got to make a choice to get up. Right? So now, if we choose to walk in godly sorrow and repent, come on, and sometimes we have to, then we can walk in that freedom. Because sometimes we have to say, you know what, Father, forgive me for what I have done. And we have to make the right choices. Now, Proverbs 27:23, you don't have to read it. It says, be diligent to know the state of your flocks and attend your herds. I have to pray every day, and I pray every day for our people. Amen. And I know some of you, you don't have to tell me what you're going through. I know what you're going through. Because God tells me. But it says here, but if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any person from among them, I'm not going to allow that to happen. Amen. And it's taken away, and their iniquity, but his blood I will require as the watchman's hand. Ezekiel 33:6, right? So we have to look for each other. And my job is to look out for your welfare. Now, I'm gonna. We may get into this a little bit more. And we haven't even touched Leviathan yet. And we'll do that next week. But I want to show you something. I want to give you some signs if you've been affected by Jezebel or influenced by it. Watch this now. Some of you, I'm not pointing any fingers, but we have to guard ourselves. Come on, and we have to examine ourselves. All right, watch this. This is the spirit of Jezebel. Refuses to admit guilt or wrong. I'll let that sink in for a little bit. Takes credit for everything. Well, we have some of those in Washington. Uses people to accomplish his agenda. Withholds information. Talks in confusion. Volunteers for everything. See, they may seem to be doing good. Lies. Ignores people. Never gives credit to show gratitude. Criticizes everyone. Sequences information. In other words, take the information and just keeps it. Squashes it. Uses information to hurt people. Talks in insanity methods. Sometimes spiritualizes everything. Is insubordinate. Is pushy and domineering. Clairvoyant. Uses the element of surprise. Sows seeds of discord. Commands attention. Is vengeful. Attempts to make you look like you are a Jezebel. because Jezebel wants to put it back on you. Insinuates disapproval. Everything you do is disapproved. Knows it all. The spirit of knowing it all. Is very ambitious, too. Even gift giving. They give gifts to manipulate. Is independent. We're supposed to be dependent on God, not independent. Is religious. And also hides. You can see sometimes may hide to themselves and not be sociable. You have a fellowship, they'd rather go out somewhere else. They don't want to hang out with people of God. Hello. This is just some of the characteristics of Jezebel. So we got to be careful with those signs. Hello? And if you have a religious spirit, it's even worse. Because the religious spirit, they judge other people by their appearance. They try to earn God's love and salvation. They try to conform to the outward holiness without inward transformation. Critical of other people, especially their walk with God. Your closest Christian relationships are based only on ministry activities. That's it. You perform Christian duties but had no passion or hunger for God. You just go through the motion. You desire position and honor in the church more than honoring God. You identify it's rooted in lifestyle being as a Christian instead of Christ-centered. You know about the truth of Yeshua, but not the way of Yeshua. You protect righteousness, but inwardly you are filled with anger and resentment. That's a religious spirit. Amen? So we're going to look at this. This is what God is talking to these seven churches. He's talking to them and saying, I see all these things you do. Some of it is okay. But look at this, what you're doing. And we have to examine ourselves this year. Everybody say amen? Amen. So we got to get back on track, right? I don't know, I wish I had more time to finish this, but I haven't even got into the Leviathan one yet. That Leviathan spirit is really prevalent and really rampant also in the world today and in the churches. And it's trying to invade. It's really trying to close us out. And just to touch bases on Leviathan, the spirit of Leviathan, remember, it almost like closes out your mind to receive even spiritual things. It just locks you out. You go through the motions, you don't feel anything. It's not a revelation inside of you. It's not real. You know, yeah, you're doing all this stuff, but I'd rather be home, you know, watching soap opera. Whatever. You know, so you got to understand, the spirit is really rampant. So we're going to get into that a little bit more. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
I wish I had more time, but we need to imagine that we have to close and got to go home. All right? Now, I know that Esther had something to say about, she came to me doing praise and worship. And can I give you a few minutes just to share what you want to share? You want to wait? Did I cover most of it or no? Yeah. Why don't you share that a little bit, if you like.
Yeah, I was having a dream this morning when I woke up and I heard God was saying different things in the dream. I was being held back by a group of men that kind of live in the project, and they were kept trying to get in the car and holding my husband and I from going where we needed to go. And I'm telling my husband, we got to get there by 2:30, and then at the moment of these men kind of like got in the car and kept holding the car back and saying, well, wait, we gotta get both some coffee, and they were saying all kinds of stuff. At the end of the dream, I'm telling my husband, babe, we gotta get there, because if we don't get there by 2:30, we're gonna have to be stuck.
chapter 2, verse 17 through 19.
Okay, we're going to read that.
And as I woke up, I was trembling, and I ran to the Bible, and I'm still shaking in this, when I'm reading about it. You can read about it.
Isaiah 2, I'm sorry?
2, verse 6, 17.
Isaiah 2, verse 17?
Mm-hmm. And I heard 17, 19, so I'm not sure if it's 17, 2, 19. But those three verses are just those two.
Amen.
You can read through them if you want.
Okay, it says here in Isaiah 2, 17, O Israel, who's Israel?
Us.
I will wipe the many names of Baal from your lips, and you will never mention them again. Hello. On that day, I will make a covenant with all the wild animals and the birds in the sky and the animals that scurry along the ground, so they will not harm you. I will remove all weapons of war from the land, or swords and bows, so you can live unafraid in peace and safety. I will make you my wife forever, showing you righteousness and justice, of failing love and compassion. I will be faithful to you and make you mine, and you will finally know me as the Lord.
Well, huh? When I woke up, I was shaking for a while, and I stopped shaking. I don't know if it was the personal word, but when I looked up John and I looked up Deuteronomy, the same chapters and verses, it's something like a warning.
Yes. Right.
We know that he is God, but then it mentions that that is why she cleansed the mouth from those names.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was reading about this, you were saying this is the year of the Lord.
Of the mouth and also
the mouth, the things that you come out of your mouth have to be clean from all these names. And whatever these names represent,
wow.
I haven't studied all of that because we came to service.
Absolutely.
You can open the Bible and use that as your declaration for promises and healing and all that stuff. That's what I will talk
about. Amen.
To cleanse your mouth from all. Also, I don't know if you have to repent.
Right.
If you use those names that you don't even know what the names are, then look them up. But we need to cleanse our mouth from these, whatever that means,
Amen. Amen. Well, let's do it. I want you to put your hand in your spirit. Let's pray. I believe that that's a warning for all of us to be careful. Look at the word. Look, this is before she even knew what I was going to mention today. She said that she gets this vision of Hosea. And so the prophet Hosea. And let me just read what it says about some of the comments here. And it's so interesting because it says about this chapter in 2:17. That the relation, in other words, the relation will be deep and personal, the kind of relationship you can know. And it says that the time will come when unfaithfulness will be impossible. God will bind us to himself in his perfect righteousness,
Amen.
Justice, come on,
yes.
Love, compassion, and faithfulness. God was promising a fresh new beginning, not just a temporary rewriting of a tired old covenant. Isn't that something? So, in other words, God's wedding gift was to his people. And he says, you're going to be my bride. But remember, we got to start speaking it. Imagine what God is saying to us. So I want you to put your hand in your spirit. Say, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, Adonai Yeshua Messiah, I believe that you are Ben Elohim,
Son of God. You are the Savior that has come in the flesh to destroy the works of the devil. You died on that tree for my sins and rose up from the dead. I now confess all my sins, known and unknown, and repent of each one. And I ask you to forgive me and cleanse me in your blood. I do believe that your blood cleanses me from all sin. Thank you for redeeming me, cleansing me, and sanctifying me in your blood. I confess as sin and seek your forgiveness for every influence, whether it's a cult, whether it's Jezebel, Leviathan, that Satan has brought that is not of God, that I will renounce every activity. I renounce Satan and all his works, and I loose myself from him, and I take back all the ground that I ever yielded to him. I choose the blessing and not the curse. I choose life and not death. In the name of Yeshua Adonai, I now renounce and break and loose myself from all demonic subjection, even from generational curses of my mother, father, grandparents, and any human being, living or dead, who have dominated and controlled me in any way. And I thank you in Yeshua's name for setting me free. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Come on, somebody. All right? Praise his holy name. Amen. God is good. Amen. How many of you received something today from God's word? Amen. Hallelujah. All right, we got to go home, man. It's getting late. Are we okay? Oh, man. That's all right. Not that bad. Well, I know we have some people today.